Welcome to the Principles of Animation workshop. So basically today we'll be explaining you and taking you through the principles of animation. If you don't know, I'll be explaining it. There are 12 principles of animation in total. Now these principles were actually derived or defined by the Disney animators, okay, where they were studying motions and in fact live studies. And when they were studying that, they realized that there are these very interesting things that they noticed, okay, and they have categorized into these 12 definite principles. So today we're going to be focusing on one of the principles, which is squash and stretch. Now squash and stretch is one of the most important principle, and I'll explain you why. Okay, anybody knows what squash and stretch exactly means? Like, the word itself is pretty, you know, clear, but anybody wants to try? So basically what she's saying is that it depends upon the object as well, okay, which means if we have, say, an object which is, say, a rock solid stiff object, when it's moving, there is no change in shape, right? There's no change in shape. But on the contrary, if we have something like, say, a balloon, right? Okay, now depending upon the way the balloon is, which means the way the object is, it's elastic, okay? So when it moves, there is a certain elasticity and inertia that applies, and there's a change in shape, okay? Now the change in shape is called as squash and stretch. Now I'll tell you what exactly squash and stretch is. We'll be giving an example of, you know, say the most simple example is a bouncing ball, okay? So basically we're going to take you through these 4-5 examples, which is normal ball, metal ball, and also we'll say how it applies to facial expressions and also how it applies to full body animations, okay? So the first example would be, so if you see this, this is animated in Flash. You can actually animate anything like this even on a flipbook, right? You have tried a flipbook before, right? So we are using Flash so that you guys can actually see it, but any software or any, even your traditional medium can help you animate, you know, the way you want. So this is a normal rubber ball, okay? Now we haven't exaggerated a bit. This is how a normal rubber ball functions. If I sort of, this won't bounce because this doesn't have a bouncy aspect, but this is, you know, how a basic normal ball will function. But suddenly if we have a ball which has more elasticity, so as you see here, it's a normal ball, okay, which doesn't have any elasticity. It has some bit of weight, okay, but it's just bouncing. Like, one thing which is very important to keep in mind is, do you think the ball is just bouncing on itself, or there are some forces acting on it? Potential and kinetic energy. Yes, so there is gravity, okay. Now gravity is the most important thing that one needs to sort of keep in mind when animating anything and everything, okay. Without gravity, until unless you're animating something in space, that's a different thing altogether. But when you're focusing on, especially for this exercise, keep in mind how high or how low your object is falling from, okay. So this is a normal ball, nothing much here, but now if we keep in mind the squash and stretch principle, and I show you another one, which is, do you notice something different here, which is basically what we have done is we have slightly exaggerated the ball here, and when it sort of falls on the ground, it shows that it's made up of rubber. It's rubbery. It's almost like, you know, balloon like. There is a different elasticity to the whole ball here. And the technical aspect is what I'm going to explain you soon, okay, where and how the stretch and squash is applied, okay. But please keep in mind when you're, just keep looking at it, and also in your head, identify the places where the squash and stretch is getting applied. Now, these are some of the examples, okay, and I think once we show you a proper one, then you'll understand. So now, something that doesn't have squash and stretch, okay, this, what kind of ball this is, any idea? It's a heavy ball, right? So the heavy ball doesn't bounce at all. Now how does it look heavy? I've not applied any squash and stretch. That's one of the most important thing. It's almost like a rigid body. There is no, it's not made up of rubber, it's a metal ball probably. Also look at the gravity that's acting. It's the moment it kind of falls from here, it goes like thud, like that, right? It's not taking its own sweet time. So we will be when we are sort of practicing this principle, we'll be trying out these different exercise, which is normal ball, rubber ball, and a heavy ball. These three major ones. Okay. Now also, I'll show you how it applies to, say, a full body. Okay. Now look at that, this animation, which is basically a jump. Okay. Now, I've kind of, obviously this is exaggerated, okay, but you see how smooth and how, there's a rhythm to the whole thing, and it looks very, like almost very rubbery, the whole action. And when it sort of falls down, he's jumping, right? When he's jumping, there's a stretch, and when it comes down, there's a squash, okay? Now, but when we actually get into animation, we'll try this out as well. We'll try it with a stick figure, because not everyone here is comfortable with, you know, figure drawing. It could be as simple as that, or it could be even simpler than that. So you don't need to get stuck in drawing to understand a principle. Okay, it can be just very simple drawings, and you can sort of animate. The other example would be your own face, technically speaking. So you see, I mean, this is a very simple face without any expression. Now, if you say, yeah. Now, if slowly you see the face, there is a stretch happening here, right? When you just you can in fact try it with your own face. There's some amount of stretch when you're trying to sort of express a shock or, you know, a smile. So your face has that bit of exaggeration. So what we had tried is try the same thing, like, you know, you just draw a face and see how we can apply these two principles, one principle, which is squash and stretch, to your face. And yeah, so you see this is a very quick one, like, where the face actually squashes the expressions. If you see, the entire facial kind of goes inside, squashing, and then it will stretch at, you know, the extremes, and then it will come down squashing again. See this? There's a certain level of squash. So now we can apply this principle very subtly, okay, at various, when you're animating anything and everything. It need not be full throttle. You need not put everything squash and stretch. Depends upon what that object is made up of. If it comes to a human being, if you're animating realistic, you would not put too much of squash and stretch. But if you're animating very, you know, simple characters, or, you know, cute ones, chubby ones, you know, you can actually add these interesting principles. So yeah, these are the few examples. And this one is another one. This is a practical, I mean, you see this one, it's just a dialogue.
You just ate rat poison.
So now, in this animation also, there's a bit of squash and stretch applied, but it's not completely, you know, there. Like, it's very subtly applied, because the moment he sort of turns and looks to one direction, and, you know, he does what, and then, you know, very subtly, we have just exaggerated and squashed it so that it looks a bit more believable and humanly, you know, in a way. It's obviously not made up of metal, you know, it's a fleshy character, okay? So you see even the mouth shapes here, right? There is, like, you can actually open your mouth and close your mouth and see how much, you know, of squash and stretch that happens. You can try that right now if you want to. Okay. Yeah, in the sense, there's a lot that can happen with face. All the dialogues, all the dialogue animation or acting animation, you know, especially character animation, we try to use this principle a lot in the face, because if you see our head, okay, we have a jaw that moves. The only thing which is there is a jaw, right? And this jaw is obviously controlled by a set of muscles, and people who are chubby, they have obviously flesh and fat. Now, this is static. So we apply a lot of squash and stretch while animating a dialogue. If you see any of the Disney work, or any work, even Indian animation for that matter of fact, we have used this a lot. Yeah, yawning is one of the example, just yawn once and you will understand, you know. You're stretching to the farthest and then you actually, you know, there's a lot that's going on there. So keep that in mind. It'll help you when you're animating, okay? So the first example that we're going to look at is ball bouncing at one place. So now we'll start the demo. And as you see, Shyam is trying to sort of draw one line as a reference. We're trying to animate a ball bouncing at the same place. So we take another layer and start drawing the frames. So as you see here, we've drawn the first frame. And then we draw the second frame slightly, you know, at a distance. And at a distance again. Now this is the point where the stretch is going to start. So as you see here, the stretching of the ball starts because the ball is being pulled by the gravity of the floor. As you see here, it's stretching more. It's stretching more. And then it's almost about to hit the ground. So we'll relook at it. We might have to change a bit of this the stretch happening because the spacing between each frame has to be correct. So now you see in the previous time where we were drawing, the overlapping was too much. Now as the ball hits the floor, it squashes. But again, there is a bit of problem in the volume, so I'll try to sort of adjust the shape of the ball overall. Now it's kind of squashing in a proper way. And now it kind of bounces back slightly. As you see now, the stretch has kind of reduced a bit, but we have to try to sort of make it slightly more so that it kind of matches the overall volume. And as it reaches the ground, slightly higher from the ground, it will sort of retain the same shape and overall volume. So as it goes higher, the hang time is more and the spacing between the frames also reduce. So as you see here, so now let's kind of play and see how, you know, the frames look like. I'll put it on a loop and let's see. So now you see it's bouncing very nicely with a nice squash and stretch happening at the point where it hits the ground and also when it's kind of, you know, midway. So you see it's a very nice movement, you know, and we will try to achieve this when we are doing the exercise. So here we'll kind of do another demo of another example of squash and stretch. So this time we're also using the same bouncing ball. And here the ball kind of enters from the left of the frame and exits. So the most important thing is to draw the arc. So you see here we have the arcs. And you know, as you see, the arc kind of reduces because the energy of the ball reduces over the period of time. So we draw the arcs for reference and on another layer we start drawing the bouncing ball. So at the highest point, the ball spacing will be less and as you draw the next frame, we'll kind of change the spacing a bit. So you see here, it's stretching now because it's been pulled by the gravity and almost very close to the ground, there's a decent amount of stretch happening.
So as the ball kind of hits the ground, it will squash in the next frame. But before it hits the ground, it stretches a bit because it's being pulled by the gravity. We'll check again and again to see if the ball is matching the definite arc. So as the ball hits the ground, now it kind of leaves, and as you see here, it's kind of retaining, you know, the shape as it reaches the hang time, which is the highest point above from the ground, and the energy of the ball will slowly gradually reduce. So you see here, keeping in mind that at the hang time, the distance between each frame is going to be very less. And keeping in mind that the volume should not change. So now when it's about to hit the ground, we are trying to sort of, you know, stretch it a bit. And when it hits the ground, it squashes. Also, one of the most important thing to notice here is that as the ball bounces, even the squash and stretch kind of reduces because the amount of energy that the ball is storing inside it and the intensity with which it hits the ground changes. So, very convincing bouncing ball that goes from the left to the right, enters the frame, will play without the arc. So you see this? So you can also see how the energy of the ball is dying down as it kind of, you know, after the multiple bounces. So yeah, you can try this out. It's a very interesting exercise and it will help you understand the squash and stretch in, you know, in a bouncing ball. So we'll take an example of a heavy ball this time. And so we'll draw a basic base from where the heavy ball will fall. So here we are trying to sort of understand how when there is no squash and stretch applied, you know, you can actually represent a heavy object here. This could be stone or a metal ball. So we'll begin with drawing the first frame here. So at the beginning of the frame, you'll make sure that the spacing is less because we are trying to sort of roll this ball off the cliff or the edge as you see here. So it slowly slides or rolls to the edge. More close when it's kind of approaching the cliff, the edge. And as you see here, it's at the edge and it almost hangs when we draw the next frame. So this frame is very critical where it's kind of almost at the edge and the next frame like this. And then here we'll first attempt a direct, you know, the next frame is directly on the ground because it's heavy. So it kind of hits the ground and it rolls off. So now, if you see here, it looks slightly weird because we don't have that one frame where it's kind of falling down. So that one frame is missing where it's at the edge of the cliff and the moment it hits the ground. So let's try to draw that one frame in between and see how it looks. So this time I will try to favor the ground so that it kind of, you know, hits with the weight. So you see, this is much, much better than the previous. It's not jarring to the eye. And it's a pretty convincing heavy ball. So you can try experimenting and animating a heavy ball. As you see, there's no squash and stretch applied to this ball. It's basically the same shape. The volume doesn't change. The shape of the ball doesn't change. So yeah. So let's now continue to the next demo. It's a very simple face. You can try it out yourself. It's not, we're not trying to get into complex facial features. And we'll see how, when the principle is applied, how it can kind of convincingly express. So there's a bit of anticipation before you kind of get into the other action, which is say smiling or shocking. So now you see here, we're trying to sort of do a stretch where the character gets into a shock state. So the expression right now is basically shocking. And you see how kind of the lower jaw kind of expands or stretches. So we'll try to draw another sort of frame here. So it's good to sort of play back and see how, you know, how smooth the action is happening. Now from that shock state, he's kind of getting into a smile or a happy face expression. We'll try to hold the frame of the shock so that, you know, it registers, and then we'll try to get into the next frame. So now we try to sort of add the stretch, a little bit of stretch, and you can exaggerate it if you want to, but this also works where, you know, trying to exaggerate the smile here and added a bit of stretch and squash, sorry, added a bit of squash to the face. See that? So it's very convincing when you see, you know, with the just 5-6 frames, we are able to sort of get this very convincing, you know, emotion across. Also in this, we'll try to add a subtle eye opening, you know, expression here so that it settles down the whole act. And now we play it and see. Might have to sort of add more hold to the shocking expression so that it registers. So yeah. So it's pretty convincing here, and hope you understood how we have applied a bit of stretch and squash to the face, to understand how this principle, you know, holds true for even expressions. So we'll move on to the other demo. So now I've drawn the first keyframe where our character is standing in an idle pose. So now the character kind of anticipates. So you see already we have kind of applying a bit of squash to the entire body, how the limbs or the legs especially kind of bend down, and he's anticipating the jump, and we'll try to push it more in the next frame by pushing him down more. So as you see here, a bit of more squash that is applied, and then he takes off. Now this is where you see how we apply the stretch to kind of push the force when he's jumping. So now in the next frame, it reaches the highest point there, and the body retracts. It kind of sort of squeezes in, you know, the other parts. And this is where our hang time begins. So we'll exaggerate it a bit more as it kind of squeezes in a bit. So now see how the legs kind of bend inside more, squashing it a bit more. And now as the ground kind of pulls the character down, you see a bit of stretch happening. It's exaggerating a bit of stretch here. So So this is the point where now we are exaggerating the stretch a lot, where the gravity is acting, you know, really hard and it's trying to pull the character. It also adds to the smooth movement and kind of makes it much more believable here. So now this is the point where the character hits the ground. So nice stretch in the previous frame, and now it's gonna kind of squash a bit as it's hit the ground. And we'll exaggerate it in the next frames. So again, we can go back and forth to test how the animation is looking so far, and it's pretty convincing so far. So now by adding a few more squash as it kind of hits the ground, it will add the cushion to the whole action and it will make it much more believable. So now let's play the whole animation, and you see here how the character is kind of jumping really, you know, nicely from one spot to the other, and with a nice hang time and a nice squash and stretch added, it makes the whole animation convincing. So hope you understood a lot about, you know, squash and stretch principle as applied to various examples. You can try your own examples and try to apply this very, very important principle of squash and stretch and experiment it on your own.
We'll have three exercises that you should be trying it on your own, okay? One would be bouncing ball, okay? Then we have facial expression, okay? Now, this is your choice. You can either do the shock to the smile or the sad to anything. It's your, you know, creativity. The third would be full body pose. Now, this could be a jump, okay? Or it could be even, say, a guy runs and hits the wall and comes back, anything that you feel like, preferably because you've seen it, so that you might want to sort of try your hand out on that, is try a jump. You can try even, say, facing the front and try the jump and coming down, just to see how far you can stretch and squash, okay? We come back, we take these files, put it here, project it and see how you guys have animated, and we'll have some corrections on it. We'll correct it ourselves. So yeah, before we get into the final exercise in Flash, we'll try to show you some examples that kind of showcase how squash and stretch is applied. They are very funny animations, some of them, and you'll see how subtly or a bit more exaggerated way how the principle has been applied. I'll just show you. So you see this, you know, like he's trying to reach to the phone, okay, but there's a lot of stretch happening there, and it's like a squishy kind of a person in the space there, and even these kind of, you know, you see this, how there's a stretch applied. So I'm treating it as a ball of, you know, a softball, like a clay ball almost, you know. And even the expressions, if you see there is a lot of, you know, the thing that we were talking about, the facial expression, you know, that has been applied here. So this is one example. There is another one. This is much interesting because this is completely frame by frame. And the yawn here, you see this? I mean, I've stretched the face so far that, you know, there is this, it's almost like made of a flesh, you know, there's this whole stretch and squash that's happening. So overall, even this thing, no, kind of stretches. So you have to do it in some percentage, you know, but you can take the liberty to stretch it really far. Yeah. This is very obvious, but this Yeah, obvious squash and stretch happening there. Also, you can apply this to motion graphics. Okay, we're using a lot of squash and stretch in motion graphics. This is one of the examples, and there are two examples which I'm going to show. In a sense, in those tiny, tiny transitions and elements, you can, you know, the whole fluidity can be brought using this particular principle. Here it's much more obvious and you can see it. You see that? This one was very important here. This whole, it kind of gets into that particular form, almost morphing like fluids. So again, at the back of the mind, when somebody's animating this, there are these 12 of them actually which apply to these kind of things. Right now, today, we're focusing only on squash and stretch. So, and trust me, when we do these bouncing ball, facial expression, and full body pose, you will, your basic will get clear, you know. There's an advanced exercise which we can probably either maybe take it later. It's called as rice sack animation, where you sort of draw a rice sack, you know, the goni, the bori that we have, and you try sort of dropping it from the top, you know. So it has a lot of volume inside it, and when it sort of gets down to the floor, you know, it will have that. You can either make it into a character which looks left and right, or you can sort of just make it relax. That's also one of the advanced exercise, because it's not just a ball, it's a sack. It has expressions, you can add a bit of hands to it also, you know. The top corners can act as hands which are moving left and right. So yeah, I'll just play this again so that you... Yeah. So mostly you can use this principle in stretch, the stretch and squash principle in the transitions. That kind of adds the fluidity. We will move on to the exercise, right? So we'll start the bouncing ball as we have briefed. We'll take the file, the flash file, open it, draw the baseline on one layer, and we'll be around to help you out. Okay? We'll begin. So this is the bouncing ball done by Archa. Okay, so let's see this. See, I believe the volume is changing a lot. Okay, because of that, it's kind of looking funny. And also at certain position, you see this, okay? Yeah, I mean, you have to make sure that the volume remains. The shape also is changing a lot. Now, this suddenly became like a throw. This won't happen. You see this? This won't really happen, I mean, until unless intended. So, maybe I can try. So, this is Nimir's basic animation. I will try to see if I can make some modification. See, also it's getting bigger. The ball, like, the size here, suddenly the stretch kind of changed here. The stretch will remain for some time. For example, let me redraw on top, say. So, say this was my, I mean, see, keep the ball round as much as possible. Okay, this goes here. Okay, I thought first that there is a baseline here. That might not happen, okay. Have you drawn arcs? Oh, there's an arc. Great. Also, this arc is too steep, okay, which means if I follow the arc, you see this, the arc will actually come here, right? Just think about it. I'm just making it like that. Okay, and say the intensity with which it's falling, maybe I'll try putting this, okay, and the squash, the out, maybe a bit of more that, the hang time probably. Again, see, the thing is, also when you're drawing on a Wacom, you will tend to do it like this. So what happens is, if the direction of the arc is like this, the ball is looking very, like, it's not on the arc, okay, which means technically it should be facing like this, following the arc like that, okay. And then maybe it kind of is off, whatever. So let's see, I don't know how correct it will be, but okay, I'll switch off the previous one. Okay, now see here, no, yeah, wait, this hang time could have been less. For example, I might remove this. even this. Let's see what happens. If you look at this particular arc, this is where it's kind of going wrong, because there's no reference arc right now. It is almost falling dead straight. You get the point? There's no arc followed with, I have not purposely followed the arc, because I'm not able to get the reference point. It's almost following the, it's not following an arc, it's following a straight line. So that's where you could probably go wrong, which I did. So you see where I went wrong here while I was even animating, because I didn't have a reference, arc. So a few things which one can probably notice here is that these arcs are good, okay, but somewhere this is too steep an arc, okay, which means it will kind of reduce, okay. This is okay, but again this becomes a very flat arc, okay. It has to have an arc, but ye bahut zyada hai. Agar ye aisa rahega, to this might even have a higher energy and then a bit and then a bit, okay. If this was from here, then it would have made sense. Okay. But yeah, so a few things which you can probably take account of here is, if this is your base, this is not how it's going to be happening. The bounce, it's not a reflection. Okay, it has to happen in an arc. Okay, one. Second is, when you're drawing, your object has to kind of follow, like when we're drawing on Wacom, that's the problem sometimes, is we tend to draw like this, okay. It has to kind of follow, because when it follows, it will have that arc automatically, you know, included inside it. What else? Anything else, Deep, if you, in this particular animation that Nimir has done? Yeah, like see, the volume suddenly becomes huge as compared to what it was. So it's like you're stretching it, but the volume should not be changing too much. So that has to be kept in mind. Okay. See, ek to ha matlab apne straight ahead karne ki koshish ki hai, but say if this is my, like, the regular whatever face, okay, and let me just, I'll take it out. Okay, so maybe there is a bit of anticipation. I'll just see what happens, okay, just follow me. I'm just doing a bit of anticipation here, okay. Okay, and now, again, slightly, I'll bring it down as well. And then maybe I'll just see. I'm just testing it out. Maybe he just sneezes, like shrinks here. Okay. And okay. बहुत ज़्यादा एग्जैजरेट करना है ना हाउ इट्स गोना बी बट लेट्स सी एंड दिस इज़ मोर ऑफ स्ट्रेट अहेड Let me just see how much this works. What? Pura? Like a swing? Like that? Yeah, it could be. I mean, I'm just trying out how it can be now. Like, huh? So, I mean, it could be even that. Like, see, even the sound there could probably make sense. Technically, yes, what you're talking about is making the mouse shape like go like that. Right? Let me put it. Add this and see. Achoo. Yeah, I mean, see, another thing is, if I would have drawn more frames here in the anticipation, right, where like, like, this could have been like, more slower, like more breathe, I'm just doing the basic frames, but if there were more in between here, and then, and even this, no, this could have been exaggerated a bit more by, like, bringing another one, which is, say I could even go that bit of irritation which is here maybe let's see this much not too much but yeah you see there's a bit of more kind of anticipation there like that so yeah your suggestion kind of works here, right? Even after this frame where that also works. Okay. Again, this is straight ahead, but just I mean it's nothing to do with it's to do with timing and a bit of how you can probably feel how the face would be. It's just your, you know, memory also. Ki how do you remember how you look when you're, you know, when I did the eye like that, okay? You know this. So the eyes usually roll up a bit, you know, if you think about it, it's not like aisa to nahi karta main, aisa to nahi karunga, right? So the small things which might add, even the mouth shape kind of becomes a bit different, right? Yeah, obviously this could have been, this is slightly off, but could have been better, like that. This is important, this keyframe, because it just kind of smashes everything, like, you know, it's that point where you don't even register that particular drawing, but I'm just putting one small thing here. So yeah, we will quickly move to the full body done by two people. Okay, we'll move to the full body done by first. We'll say Mrunal has done something. Okay, let's see. Hey, nice. Yeah, I mean, yeah, he almost slided there. See, this is nice, okay, but he's just like, ooh. Let me just check the spacing of it as well to see how much have you kept that in mind. Oops. Right, so yeah, see, it looks cool because there is a bit of, yes, I mean, you know, this distance is nice, the way the gradual spacing happens. This is good understanding here, at least a bit of it, right? See, this is the first, right? This goes forward. This is your second, okay? And this goes back now, and technically back to this. There's no contact. There's basically no this. This pose is not there, right? ये नहीं है ना. अगर ये होता ना, तो वो at least convincing हो जाता था. But good one, man. Good, nice attempt. At least you tried. और किसका था? शिवानी. कितने फ्रेम है? 6 फ्रेम. Yeah, I mean, just to do quick corrections, I mean, see, there is no, ये क्या हुआ ऐसे, मतलब मुरझाया हुआ है क्यों ये? Like say, for example, he is standing like that, right? I'll do it on above. Eric, he's standing. Sorry. Switch this. He's standing, then. If he's not anticipating, maybe he does take off his hands like that, and maybe he kind of anticipate ki bhai main abhi jhukne wala hu, right? More, maybe, and then gaya, could be, let's see. Like I would just let him exit because there was enough anticipation to it, so. Yeah, and let it pass off the frame. Yeah, and yes, the frame rate 24 ki jagah main 12 pe dekhta hun. Right? Like just adding a bit of anticipation, nothing else. At least it's not like
even if you use that animation, you have to scale it.
हाँ जस्ट एक फ्रेम राइट
एक दो फ्रेम ऐड करके जस्ट टेक दैट थिंग एंड स्केल इट डाउन
या अभी तो प्रॉपर ऐसा उड़ रहा है वो लाइक सी देयर इज नो लाइक इट जस्ट लेफ्ट मतलब आई कुड लिटरली लाइक यू नो हैव समवन हियर विद अ फुलझड़ी एंड लाइटिंग हिम अप. So it's not a rocket, right? It has, I mean, it's a guy with something and stuff. So yeah, again, see, full body pose, not everybody has explored squash and stretch properly. Even yours, I mean, it was more of a movement rather than exploration. The idea was to sort of get that whole bounciness by using the squash and stretch, which that's why in most of the animation courses, bouncing ball is something that most of us kind of try to animate, because by doing that, the amount of stretch and squash you apply to these, you know, just the ball itself, will give you an understanding of how it is. Now, what we'll do is probably next session, we'll have the rest of the principle that will come in place. And when we use that principle along with this understanding, it's basically layering. There are 12 layers now, you know, there are technically 11 layers more to understand. And then we'll approach complex animation as well as we go slightly further. Okay. But yeah, thank you so much for, you know, being a part of this and hoping for the next session with you guys.